Hello, good morning everyone. My name is Dr. Yang. Today's topic is diagnosis and treatment planning and also referral writing. So, what is the learning outcome of this lecture? Firstly, by the end of this lecture, you need to know how to define and classify the diagnostic aids. You also should be able to explain the sequence of extraoral and intraoral findings. You also need to know the outline of the extraoral and intraoral finding. You also need to know how to assess the skeletal growth of individual by skeletal maturity indicators. And you also should be able to discuss the provisional diagnosis based on the findings and also to compare the different types of X-ray for diagnostic purpose. So now, what is a diagnosis? Diagnosis is to concern among and to know the difference between different malocclusion. According to Robert E. Moyes, diagnosis is the determination of presence or absence of the abnormal or the undesired. And then according to Graber and Rakosi, it is the recognition and systematic designation of anomalies, the practical synthesis of finding, permitting therapy to be planned and indication to be determined, and thereby enabling the doctor to act. So, what should a dentist must do? During the diagnosis and treatment planning, the dentist should recognize the various characteristics of the malocclusion and dentofacial deformity. The dentist also should be able to understand the nature of the problem and the etiology. And then the dentist also should know how to design a treatment plan based on the specific needs of the individual. This is the basic treatment plan. It's not the complicated treatment plan that usually done by the orthodontist. The goal of the diagnostic procedure is to produce a complete description of patient problems and make a problem list. The treatment plan is derived from this problem list. So from the diagnosis, we will gather data, and then from the data is a science and the truth, and there is no opinion of judgment, whereby the treatment planning is something that we plan to correct the malocclusion. It's a wisdom and it's an art form. How to obtain a problem list? So in order to obtain a problem list, we need to collect a data, and then this collection is called a database. The database is obtained from three sources. Firstly is the patient history and interview data. Secondly is the clinical examination based on the general examination, extraoral examination, intraoral and functional examination. And thirdly is the analysis of the diagnostic records. So what is the diagnostic records? Diagnostic records is models, radiographs, cephalograms, photographs, and so forth. According to T.M. Graber, there are two types of diagnostic criteria. The first one is the essential diagnostic criteria, and the second one is supplemental. Essential diagnostic criteria is considered very important for all cases. It consists of case history, clinical examination, plaster study casts, radiographs such as OPG, intraoral periapical radiograph and bite wings, and also clinical photograph. For the supplemental diagnostic criteria, it consists of cephalometric head plates such as the lateral ceph and frontal, sensory occlusion and functional records, and then occlusal radiograph, Henry's X-ray, selected jaw views, and electromyography examination of muscle activity. According to Graber and Rakosi, comprehensive diagnosis is obtained from various methods. Firstly, is from the case history. Secondly, clinical examination. Then functional analysis, followed by cephalometry analysis, and then photographic analysis, and then study cast analysis, and finally is from the radiography examination. According to W.R. Profit, the database is collected from the patient history, clinical examination, and the diagnostic records. And then from the database, Problem list will be formulated, and then the case is diagnosed. And then firstly, before we start any treatment, we need to correct any pathology in that patient. For example, if patient has caries, we need to do filling first. If patient have a bariatric problem, we need to have a gum treatment first. Then only we start with orthodontic treatment. And then when we want to start the orthodontic treatment, we need to have a patient-parents consult, and then the treatment plan, and then finally the consent. So now we will go into the detail of each one of the essential diagnostic aids. So the first one is the case history. Case history involves eliciting a recording of relevant information from the patient and parents to aid in overall diagnostic of the cases. What we need to know from the case history, firstly, is the personal details, such as the age, and then the gender, the name of the patient. And then secondly, we need to know the chief complaint, why patient want to do braces. And then secondly, and also we need to know the reason for treatment. And then we also need to know the family history, medical history, the dental history, prenatal history, and postnatal history. For the next slide, I will go into detail of each of this history. And then firstly, the personal details. We need to know the patient name. Patient name must be recorded for the purpose of identification and communication. And then the patient age is important because we need to record the chronological age. Age consideration helps in diagnosis and treatment planning. Growth modification procedure are carried out during the growth period. So from our previous lecture about growth, you need to revise again. Well, when is the patient growth spurt for males and females, because it's a very important age where we want to start the growth modification. And then we also need to know the gender, because the timing of growth spurt is different in males and females. We also need to record the address and occupation for communication and for assessing the socioeconomic status and for records. Then for the chief complaint, we need to record the patient chief complaint of his or her own words. For example, why you want to do braces? So I want to do braces because I want to straighten my front teeth. So you need to write, patient want to straighten his or her front teeth in the case note. And then you should not include scientific or medical terms in the chief complaint. And then this helps the clinician to identify the priorities and expectation of the patient. Okay, for example, patient has a class 3 skeletal with reverse overjet of 10 mm, for example. And then we need to assess what is the patient's chief complaint, whether patient want to correct the jaw or patient want to correct the teeth only. Because if patient want to correct the jaw, we need to consider orthodontic surgery for that patient together with the braces. Okay, next one is the reason for treatment. Reason for seeking treatment will affect the aesthetic, functional, hygiene, and speech of the patient. We also, from this reason for treatment, we also can assess the motivation of the patient, either internal or external. Meaning, internally, meaning that patient is really keen for treatment. External motivation is usually from the parents. The best treatment is when the parents is very supportive for the treatment, and the patient also very keen for treatment. Usually in cases where patient doesn't want any treatment, but the parents, the external motivation is high in parents, usually the treatment prognosis is poor because the patient himself or herself doesn't have any motivation for the treatment. For the family history, we also need to ask the patient whether his or her parents has a similar malocclusion. For example, in class 3 cases, usually the patient will inherit the class 3 from the parents because it's mainly genetic. And then for the history of orthodontic treatment, we need to ask whether there is any sibling or any family member also have any orthodontic treatment, because it might affect their motivation as well. And then for the medical history, you need to ask the patient whether the patient has any medical problems as usual, even though because this medical history will affect in the braces treatment. So I think you will have a lecture about the medical problem in dentistry. So this is the list of the disease that may affect the orthodontic treatment. Okay, for the diabetes, if patient have diabetes, usually we need to consider the treatment in the early mornings. And then for the patient for blood disorder, we need to consider when we want to do extraction prior to orthodontic treatment. And then analgesic, we need to consider analgesic because sometimes orthodontic treatment may cause pain. And then in patient with rheumatoid arthritis, rheumatoid fever, neuromuscular disorder, allergies and surgery, we also need to consider before we do orthodontic treatment. For the dental history, we need to ask the patient about the history of extraction, restoration, previous treatment and early loss of deciduous teeth because it might affect in our treatment planning. And then the dental history also helps in evaluation of patient and parents' attitude towards treatment. If patient have a very good motivation, patient will go to visit dentist once in a year. And then in this patient, we will have a good motivation towards treatment. And then for the prenatal history, we need to ask the health of mother during pregnancy. And then we also need to ask a history of the disease, whether patient has any bacterial or viral disease, any medication taken, any radiation being exposed, and any trauma during the prenatal history. Okay. And then we also need to ask the mother the type of delivery, whether is it normal, cesarean or forceps, because forceps delivery may sometimes result in TMJ injuries leading to ankylosis of the joint. And then this can manifest as marked retardation in the growth of the mandible, as we seen in this photo. And then for the postnatal history, we need to ask the parents what type of feeding during the patient is still a baby. And then is there any presence of habits such as a thumb sucking habit? And then we also need to ask the milestone of normal development such as standing, walking, running or speech. For example, if patient has a delay in standing or walking, it may also have a delay in teeth eruption. Okay, next we will go into clinical examination. We will go one by one from the general examination, extraoral examination, functional examination and then intraoral examination. General examination is a general assessment of the patient. A good clinician usually begins his general examination as soon as patient enters the clinic. So what will you check in general examination? You will check for the patient height, width, gait and body build. So the height and weight of the patient should be recorded because it provides a clue to the physical growth and maturation of the patient. And for the gait is the way a person walks. Abnormalities of gait are usually associated with neuromuscular disorder that may have a dental correlation. For the body build, we need to see the patient aesthetic. They may have a thin physique and usually possess a narrow dental arches. And for the plethoric physique, they are persons who are obese. They generally have large and square dental arch. For the athletic physique, they are considered normally built, being either thin or obese. They have normal size dental arch. And then there is another classification of the body type, which is introduced by Sheldon. There are three types of body type, which is ectomorphic, mesomorphic, and endomorphic. Endomorphic is a tall and thin physique. Mesomorphic is an average physique, and endomorphic is short and obese physique. For the shape of the head by Martin and Seller, the head can be classified into three types, which is the mesocephalic, dolichocephalic, and brachycephalic. So how to check which type of the head? So we need to measure the skull width and the skull length. The maximum skull width is a distance between the tangent to the parietal bone. And then the maximum skull length is the distance between the tangent to the frontal and occipital bone. So this is a formula on how to check for the cephalic index. So the maximum skull width should be divided with the maximum skull length and then times 100. So if you get less than 75.9, we call it a dorsicocephalic, which is the long and narrow head or long skull. If you get the numbering between 76 to 80.9, it is called mesocephalic. Mesocephalic is the average shape of head and they possess a normal dental arch. If the cephalic index is 81 to 85.4, patient will have a brachycephalic, which is a short skull, and patient may also have broad and short head. They may have a broad and dental arch. And if patient have a scoring of the cephalic index less than 85.5, patient will have hyperbrachycephalic, meaning as a very short skull. The next one is the shape of the face or facial form, which is introduced by Martin and Seller. The simple way of describing the face is to classify it as round, oval, or square. There is a more scientific classification is there is a three types, which is a mesoprosopic, uriprosopic, and leptoprosopic. And then in order to classify the facial form into these types, so firstly, we need to measure the morphological facial height, which is the distance between the nasion and genation, and then bizygomatic width, which is the distance between the tangents of the two zygomatic points. So from the image, the distance between the tangent of the two zygomatic points. Zygomatic point is labeled as ZY. And then for the morphological facial height, the distance between the nasion and genation. And the nasion is labeled as N and the nasion is labeled as GN. This is the formula to measure the morphological facial index, which is FI, where the morphological facial height is divided with the bizygomatic width and times 100. So if we get the value between 84 to 78.9, it is a mesoprosopic facial form, which is an average or normal facial form. This facial form will affect the arch form, and then the arch form will be U-shaped normal arch. And then for the leptoprosopic, patient will have a long and narrow facial form and also a narrow and apical base arches. And the value of the facial index will be between 88 to 92.9. If the value is greater than 93, patient has a hyperleptoprosopic, which is an extremely long face. And then for the value of 79 to 83, patient is a uroprosopic, which is the face is broad and short, and then the arch also broad and square arches. If patient has a value less than 78.9, patient is a hyperuroprosopic, which is short with low facial index. This three photos shows the difference between the three facial forms. The first one is the mesoprosopic facial form, which is the average type. And then for the patient, we have a mesoprosopic face, will also have a horseshoe shape or oval dental arch form. And then for the patient with a leptoprosopic facial form, the face is long and narrow. And then patient also will have long and narrow V-shaped arches. For uroprosopic facial form, patient has a short and wide face. And then patient also have a U-shaped or squarish arch form. Now we will move into extraoral examination. In order to check a patient extraorally, we need to ask patient to sit upright on the dental chair and the face is examined from the front or in profile view in a natural head position. So how to achieve natural head position in a patient? So firstly, we need to ask the patient to sit upright and then to look at the distance in front. Then only we can assess the patient profile properly. So this is the list of what you need to check during your extraoral examination. First, start with the hard tissue examination, then followed by soft tissue examination. what you need to check in the hard tissue examination. You need to check the skeletal relationship in the three planes, which is the sagittal or anterior posterior, vertically or transversely. And then you also need to check for any problem in the temporomandibular joint, whether it is normal or is there any clicking on the right or left side, and then is there any deviation during opening and closing. And for the soft tissue, you need to look at the face and the soft tissue passively. You need to check whether the patient has competent lips or incompetent lips or potentially competent lips or any lower lip trap. You also need to check for the nasolabial angle of the patient, whether it is acute, average or obtuse. You also need to check for the labiomental angle of this patient, whether it is deep, shallow or normal. And you also need to check for the patient chin. For the sagittal or anterior-posterior skeletal relationship, you need to check in a profile view, meaning that you need to check from the lateral side of the patient. And then the patient teeth should be in a central occlusion. And then use your index and middle finger and palpate the anterior border of the maxilla and the mandible. Okay, this is how you want to check the anterior-posterior jaw relationship. You need to, this picture shows that how you need to put the fingers at the soft tissue A and B point. Ideally, the maxilla is around 2 to 3 mm anterior to the mandible in a central occlusion. In the class 2 cases, the index finger is much ahead of the middle finger, whereas in the class 3, the middle finger is ahead of the index finger. You will learn this more during your clinical session. Okay, and then I will show you during your practical. Besides using the index finger and your middle finger, there is another way to assess the patient profile is by using two reference lines. The first line is the line joining the forehead and the soft tissue point A, which is the deepest point in the curvature of upper lip. And then the second reference line is the line joining the point A and the soft tissue pogonion, which is the most anterior point of the chin. Based on the relationship between these two lines, three types of profile exist, which is straight profile. Straight profile usually is a class 1 skeletal pattern, where the two lines formed are nearly in straight line. Secondly, the convex profile, usually in a class 2 skeletal pattern, the two lines form an angle with the concavity facing the tissue. This kind of profile occurs as a result of proactive maxilla or retroactive mandible, as seen in a class 2 division 1 occlusion. And the third one is a concave pattern profile, where the two reference line forms an angle with the convexity towards the tissue. This type of profile is associated with a prognathic mandible or a retrognathic maxilla, as in a class 3 malocclusion. Facial divergence is defined as an anterior and posterior inclination of the lower face relative to the forehead. It can be divided into three types, which is the anterior, posterior and straight. And then for the posterior divergent, a line drawn between the forehead and chin slants posteriorly towards the chin. For the straight or orthognathic, the line between the forehead and chin is straight or perpendicular to the floor. And then for the anterior divergent, a line drawn between the forehead and chin is inclined anteriorly towards the chin. The facial divergence is to a large extent influenced by patient ethnic and racial background. Okay, after you check for the sagittal anterior posterior relationship, the next one you need to check for the vertical relationship during your extraoral examination. What you need to check during your vertical relationship is the lower anterior facial height, and then secondly is the Frankfurt mandibular plane angle. So now, what you need to check for the lower anterior facial height in relation to the total facial height? Total facial height is measured between the base of the hairline, or what we call trichion, until the soft tissue menton. This is total facial height. And then for the lower anterior facial height is measured from the base of the nose to the soft tissue menton. So the first photo, we can see that the lower third of the face is around average size between the middle part of the face and the upper part of the face. So this is what we call average lower anterior facial height in relation to the total facial height. And the middle photo shows that the lower anterior facial height is slightly reduced than the middle and the upper facial height. So we can say that this patient has a reduced lower anterior facial height in relation to the total facial height. And the third and the last photo, you can see that patient has a slightly increased lower anterior facial height in relation to the total facial height. So you can check this by eyeballing and from the imaginary line. Okay, now we will move into the Frankfurt mandibular plane angle. There are three types where the Frankfurt mandibular plane angle is average, reduced, or increased. So this angle is formed between two planes. The first plane is the Frankfurt plane. The Frankfurt plane is derived from the lowest point of the lower body of the bony orbits and the most superior margin of the external auditory meatus, whereas the mandibular plane is a line drawn at the inferior border of the body of the mandible. Average Frankfurt mandibular plane angle is when these two planes intersect at the occipital region. And then reduced Frankfurt mandibular plane angle is when these two planes intersect behind the occipital region. And for patients with increased Frankfurt mandibular plane angle is when these two planes intersect in front of the occipital region. The facial height of or the vertical skeletal relationship can also be assessed by studying the angle formed between the lower border of the mandible and the Frankfurt horizontal plane. Frankfurt horizontal plane is a line between the most superior point of external auditory meatus and inferior border of orbit. Normally, the two planes intersect at occipital region, so the angle will be around 25 degrees. In case of two planes meet beyond the occipital region, it indicates a low angle case or horizontal growing phase, and then the angle will be less than 15 degrees. If the two planes meet anterior to the occipital region, it indicates a high angle case or vertical growing phase, and then the angle will be more than 35 degrees. Okay, after you measure the sagittal anterior posterior relationship and vertical relationship, you also need to measure the transverse relationship of the extraoral examination of this patient. You need to assess any significant facial asymmetry, and the asymmetry of lower face is common in a class 3 malocclusion with prognathic mandible. When we look at this figure, the facial midline is dropped perpendicular to the interpapillary line, provided the orbits are level. In this patient, there is deviation of the nasal tip to the right and a shift in the upper dental center line and the chin point to the left. And then vertically for the facial symmetry, we will also call it as a transverse plane. In this plane, the inner face is divided sagittally into 5 equal parts or fifth. Each of the segments should be equal in size to the width of one eye. The 5 fifths are the central fifth of the face, 2 middle fifths, and the lateral 2 lateral or outer fifth of the face. The central fifth is between 2 vertical lines that passes through the inner canthi of the eye. The medial fifth represents the width of the eye. The outer fifth of the face are measured from the base of the ear to the helix of the ear. In the inner face, the distance that separates the two eyes should be equal to the width of the eye. The interpapillary distance should equal the width of the mouth. So this is the photo of the symmetric face where we can see that the width is equal to each other. And for the asymmetric face, we can see that the outer width is larger than the other fifth. Okay, once you finish checking for the sagittal, vertical and transverse relationship of the heart tissue during your extraoral examination, don't forget to check for the TMJ, the temporomandibular joint. You need to palpate the temporomandibular joint and ask the patient to open and close their mouth slowly. You need to check for any sign or symptom of clicking, crepitus, any pain, any locking and any trismus. Okay, after you're done checking for the heart tissue examination, you also need to check for the soft tissue. You need to check for the nasolabial angle, mentolabial fold, the lips and the chin. For nasolabial angle, is the angle formed between the lower border of the nose and a line connecting the intersection of nose and upper lip with the tip of the lip, or labially superiors. This angle is normally 110 degrees, or between 90 degrees to 110 degrees. It reduces in patients having proclined upper incisor or prognathic maxilla, and then it increases in patients with retrognathic maxilla or retroclined maxillary anterior. So when the nasolabial angle is increased, it is called obtuse nasolabial angle, and when the nasolabial angle is decreased, it is called acute nasolabial angle. So now, how we want to examine the lips? The lips can be examined within the size, the posture, and the lips tonicity. Normally, the upper lips covers the entire labial surface of the upper anteriors except the incisor, around 2 to 3 mm. The lower lip covers the entire labial surface of the lower anterior and 2/3 millimeter of the incisor edge of the upper anteriors. So, we can classify this as normal. If the upper lip is short, usually we can see there is the lips are incompetent. Thin upper and lower lips, and sometimes we can see thick and inverted lower lips. I will show you the photo later. And then for the posture, we can examine the lips within three types of lip, which is either competent, incompetent, or potentially competent lips. We also need to examine the lip tonicity of the patient. So this photo shows that patient has competent lips. And then this is a photo shows incompetent lips. So incompetent lips can be divided into three types, whether is it anatomical due to short upper lips, whether it is dental due to proclination of the upper incisor. So if the incompetent lips is due to proclination of the upper incisor, usually this can be corrected to become competent after braces treatment, after orthodontic treatment. And then another one, incompetent lips due to physiological problem. Patient will have a mouth breathing that causing the lips to be incompetent. This photo shows potentially competent lips or lower lip traps. Usually we can see this lower lip trap in a severe class 2 division 1 cases where the upper incisors will lie in front of the lower lip, and then the lower lip is being trapped behind the lower incisor. And then because of this, it prevents proper lip seal. Another one, you need to look for the lip tonicity. The first photo shows that patient has competent lips with normal tonicity of the lips, and the middle photo shows that patient has a high tonic lips, and patient also force the mentalis muscle to get the lip seal. And then we can see that patient has a hyperactive mentalis muscle on the chin. And then the final photo shows that patient has a very weak muscular tonicity of the lips, and patient has a inverted upper and lower lips. The next slide is about how to examine the chin. Firstly, we need to look for the mentolabial sulcus. The mentolabial sulcus is a concavity seen below the lower lip, Normally, we can see that the average maintolabial sulcus will appear, especially in a patient with a class 1 profile. And then, patient will have a shallow maintolabial sulcus in a patient with a bimaxillary protrusion, as we seen in the middle photo. And then, deep maintolabial sulcus is usually seen in a class 2 division 1 more occlusion, which we can see in the final photo. Don't forget to check for the chin prominence. Usually, patient will have adequate chin in the class 1 skeletal. And then, patient may have recessive chin in the patient with a class 2 skeletal. And then, in a class 3 skeletal, patient may have excessive chin. And then finally, for the chin, you also need to check for the mentalis activity. In a patient with a lower lid tract, patient may have hyperactive mentalis muscle. Now, we will look for the functional examination. Normal function of the stomatognathic system promotes normal growth and development of orofacial structures. So, what should you check for the functional examination? Firstly, you need to check for the posterior rest position and interocclusal space. Secondly, you need to check for the path of closure of the mandible. You also need to check for the assessment of respiration. Don't forget to check for the TMJ, the temporomandibular joint. And then, you need to check for the swallowing pattern, and then you also need to examine the speech of the patient. Now, what you need to look for the posterior rest position and interocclusal clearance. Posterior rest position is the position of the mandible at which the muscle that closes the jaw and those that open them are in state of minimal contraction to maintain the posture of the mandible. At posterior rest position, a space exists between the upper and lower jaws, and this space is known as freeway space. The freeway space or interocclusal clearance is normally 3 mm in the canine region. What is the method used to record the posterior rest position? There are three methods. There are few methods can be used. Firstly, the phonetic methods. The patient is asked to repeat some consonant such as M or C or repeat a word like Mississippi. Mandible returns to posterior rest position 1 to 2 seconds after the exercise. The patient is told not to change the jaw, lip or tongue position after phonation as the dentist path the lip to study interocclusal space. The second method is a command method. The patient is asked to perform certain functions such as swallowing, and the mandible tends to return to rest position following this act. The third method is the non-command method, where the patient is observed as he speaks or swallows, and the patient is not aware that he or she is being examined. Now, what is the method to measure the interocclusal clearance? You need to use the vernier calipers, and then you can check intraorally or extraorally. Intraorally, you can use the vernier calipers directly in the patient's mouth, in the canine or incisor region to measure the freeway space. For extraoral, you need to get two reference points, which is at the nose and chin in the mid-sagittal plane. And then patient should be in occlusion and at rest position to measure the freeway space. Path of closure is a movement of mandible from rest position to habitual occlusion. There are three types of the path of closure, which is forward, backward and lateral. Forward path of closure occurs in patients with mild skeletal or edge-to-edge incisor contact. In such patients, the mandible is guided to a more forward position to allow the mandibular incisor to go labial to the upper incisor. Backward path of closure is in a class 2, division 2, where it will exhibit a premature incisor contact due to retrocline maxillary incisor. Thus, the mandible is guided posteriorly to establish occlusion. For the lateral path of closure, is a lateral deviation of the mandible to the right side or the left side in association associated with occlusal prematurities and a narrow mandibular arch. You also need to check for how patient breathe. So you need to check whether patient breathe to the nose or nasal respiration. whether patient breathe to the mouth or oral respiration, or patient breathe from both nose and the mouth, oral nasal respiration. So there are many tests that you can do. First, you can use a mirror test or fog test. This is a very simple test that you can test whether patient is a mouth breather or nasal breather or both. You can put the mirror at the patient nose. If there is a fog appear at the mirror, meaning that patient is the nasal breather. If you put the mouth mirror in the mouth and then you can see there is a fogging on the mirror, it shows that patient is the mouth breather. So when you put both mirror on the nose and the mouth, and you can see both mirror have fogging, and then patient will have oral nasal respiration. And then the other test, you can also use a cotton test, water holding test, or you can observe how patient breathe. Now, how you want to examine the temporomandibular joint? The functional examination should routinely include auscultation and palpation of the temporomandibular joint and musculature associated with the mandibular opening. The patient should be examined for the symptom of TMJ problem like clicking, crepitus, pain, limitation of jaw movement, hypermobility, and morphological abnormalities. The maximum mouth opening is determined by measuring the distance between the maxillary and mandibular incisor edge with mouth wide open. The normal inter-incisor distance is around 40 to 45 mm. Now, how you want to examine the swallowing pattern? In a newborn, tongue is relatively large and protrudes between the gum pad and takes part in establishing the lip seal. This kind of swallow is called infantile swallow. The infantile swallow is replaced by mature swallow as buccal teeth start to erupt. Persistence of infantile swallow can cause malocclusion. The persistence of infantile swallow is indicated by the following features. First, the protrusion of the tip of the tongue. Second, contraction of perioral muscle during swallowing. And thirdly, non-contact of the molar region during swallowing. This picture shows the anatomy of the tongue when patient swallow. This is not normal because the tongue is protrudes forward during swallowing. This may cause proclination of the upper and lower incisor, and sometimes it will cause a spacing of the upper and lower incisor teeth. Now, how you want to examine the speech? Certain malocclusion may cause defect in speech due to interference with the movement of the tongue and lips. This should be observed while talking with patient. Patient can be asked to read out from a book or asked to count from 1 to 20. Patient with tongue thrust habit tend to lips while deep bite patient may find it difficult to pronounce Z and S. So for patient who have tongue thrusting habit, they will have lisping speech. Lisping speech meaning that patient unable to say the word S properly. For example, we can ask patient to say some words in S, but patient will say something. For example, we ask the patient to say lips, but patient will tend to say lith. So they cannot say the word S properly. So for the intraoral examination, what you need to check is, firstly, you need to check for the soft tissue. Secondly, you need to check for the hard tissue, which is the teeth. You also need to check for the whole mandibular arch. Then you also need to check for the whole maxillary arch. Then only you ask patient to bite, and then you check for the inter-arch relationship of the teeth. For the soft tissue examination, firstly, the most important one, you need to check for the oral hygiene status. You need to check, is there any plaque, any calculus and everything? And also you need to check for the gingiva, whether there is a gingivitis, there is a bleeding on probing, And also, you need to check for the tongue. Is there any tongue tie? Is there any tongue thrusting habit? And so forth. You also need to check for the palatal contour. You need to check whether there is a presence of torus. You need to check for the frenal attachment, especially for the upper labial frenum, because a very flabby upper labial frenum will cause median decima, that, like what you see in this photo. And in patient with midline decima, you need to check the upper labial frenum as well. And then you need to do a Blanche test. A Blanche test is when you pull down the upper labial frenum. You need to pull the upper lips forward. Then you can see there is a blanching of the frenum behind the upper lateral incisors. If I got the chance, I will show this during your clinical classes. So for the hard tissue examination, the first one, the most important thing is you need to count the teeth. You need to count the teeth. For example, look at these two photos. Okay, you need to count the teeth. You need to make sure, you need to count from number one, from the lower central incisor as number one, and then lateral incisor as number two, canine as number three, first premolar as number four, and then second premolar as number five. And then look at this photo. This is not second premolar. This is deciduous teeth. So in this case, do not charting as second premolar. This is not second premolar. This is deciduous teeth. That's why you need to count the teeth. And then look at the below photo. Okay. You can see, you need to count the teeth. Lower central incisor as number one, lateral incisor as number two, and then canine as number three from both sides. So, look at the lower photo. Actually, in this photo, patient only have three lower incisors, not four lower incisors. This patient has missing one lower incisors. So, please count the teeth properly. Do not present as all teeth present without counting the teeth properly. Okay, this is common mistake. Even until you graduated, even until you are a valid dental officer, you were still doing this mistake. Okay, please count the teeth properly. Okay, please do not do this mistake when you are working later. And then you also need to see, you need to check for any unerupted teeth. You also need to check for supernumerary teeth, check for any missing teeth. You also need to check for the size, the shape, and the form of teeth, check for any caries, and check for any endodontically treated teeth and any occlusal wear. The next one, you need to check for the maxillary and the mandibular arch. Firstly, look at the arch form. You can say that this patient has a U-shaped maxillary arch form or V-shaped maxillary or mandibular arch form. And then you also need to check for any individual tooth abnormality. If patient presented with a pet-shaped laterus, you can present this at this part. Okay, and then you also can say patient has a rotated teeth on the lower labial segment. There is, for example. And you also need to check for the alignment of the teeth. You can see that patient has a very deep curve or speed on the lower. You also can see that patient has displaced teeth or buccally erupted canine during your presentation later. Okay, after that, when you're done checking for the soft tissue, the hard tissue, the maxillary and mandibular arch, then only you ask patient to bite properly and then you check for inter-arch relationship. What you need to check is you need to check for the incisor relationship, the canine relationship, and the molar relationship, whether the relationship is in class 1, class 2, or class 3. Okay, later you will have a lecture about the malocclusion, the class 1 malocclusion, the class 2 malocclusion, and the class 3 malocclusion, where you can learn more about this and how to explain this during your presentation later. And then don't forget to check for the object. You need to measure how many millimeter of the object. Normal object is around 2 to 4 mm. So any measurement above 4 mm is increased object, and any measurement below 2 mm is called reverse object. Don't forget to check for the vertical relationship of the upper and lower teeth. Patient may have deep bite, or patient may have open bite. If patient have deep bite, you need to measure if patient have open bite, you need to measure how many mm of the open bite, where in this picture is around 3 mm open bite. And then you also need to check for the transverse relationship, whether patient has any cross bite or any scissors bite. So it's quite simple to check intraorally, okay? Okay, I understand this is quite a long lecture. We have over 100 slides. I hope you can still pay your attention. Actually, we already finished the most important part of this lecture, which is the patient history and the clinical examination. Now we will move to the analysis of the diagnostic record. Okay, what is the most important diagnostic record? Usually in the exam question, we will ask you to list down what is the diagnostic record for treatment planning. So you just write study model, cephalometric analysis, skeletal maturity indicators, radiograph, photograph, and any other x-rays. Okay, now we already finished off about the diagnostic record. It's okay. Right now, we will move into how to formulate problem list, and then how to formulate the treatment objective, and then how to formulate the treatment plan. Actually, this is what you need to know at the entry level. You doesn't need to know too much about this topic, because this is what I learned during my 3 years master program. So in 3 years, you will learn about problem list, treatment objective, and treatment plan. Imagine you learn this in 1 hour only. So you need to know the basic thing about this. Okay, don't pressure yourself. In this topic, what you need to learn more is about the patient history taking, clinical examination, and diagnostic records. Okay, you need to know how to collect the data from the patient properly. Okay, for the treatment planning is a master level. Okay. Okay, now we will look into example. This patient is FP. So FP chief complaint is my front teeth are crooked and my smile is ugly. So based on the history, patient has a good health, regular medical and dental care, and wears contact lenses. Post-menarche is more than 24 months, meaning that patient already have menstruation more than 2 years ago. And then orthodontic treatment planned earlier and delayed because their family are moving out from somewhere. And then as for motivation, patient has a largely internal and wants treatment very much. Patient has a good attitude, understand treatment procedure because friends have been treated. So when we took a patient history, you need to ask whether is there any family member also having orthodontic treatment? Do you have any friends having orthodontic treatment? Because this may affect the patient motivation towards treatment. And then for the patient expectation, patient wants to have a better appearance. And then patient also wants to have less social stress. Patient has no concern about function, and patient expectation seems realistic. Okay, for patient expectation, you also need to assess in the very beginning when taking history, because some patient, they think by doing braces they can get a beautiful smile like Angelina Jolie. Usually this is not realistic expectation. So in order to treat orthodontic patient history is very important. Okay, after that is other pertinent information. You need to know where the patient live with both parents, have a good school performance, and there is no apparent social problem like bullying because of a protruding incisors and so forth. Okay, the next one is the clinical examination data. We need to know the health of hard and soft tissue. There is no caries, no restoration. Tissue irritation around erupting mandibular right second molar. Occasionally, there is pain around the area. Minimal attached gingiva, mandibular anterior, and mandibular incisor region. And then for the jaw function, maximum voluntary opening is 40 mm. Normal lateral and protrusive movement. There is no joint sound, no pain on palpation. For the facial proportion, generally symmetric but chin slightly to the left. Lower third vertically short. For the profile, mildly mandibular deficient and relatively large nose and chin and deep labiomental fold. For diagnostic records needed, they took OPG but there is no intraoral film for this patient. They also take lateral cephalometric radiograph, but there is no posterior anterior cephalometrics. They also took a study model, the dentacals, and intraoral and extraoral photograph. Then, based on the Ackerman profit classification, this is the analysis of the diagnostic record. For the facial proportion and aesthetic, patient FP have short face and relatively large nose and chin for lips. For the dental alignment and symmetry, patient have mild mandibular and moderate maxillary crowding. For the transverse relationship, there is no asymmetry. Okay. For the anteroposterior relationship, patient has a class 2 skeletal with mild mandibular deficiency and angle class 2 division 2 incisor relationship. For the vertical relationship, patient has extreme overbite and then patient has short facial height and there is also elongation of maxillary and mandibular incisors. So now, I will give you some example of the cases where we will look on the patient history, clinical examination, diagnostic records, and how to formulate the problem list. Usually, we formulate the problem list from the patient facial proportion and aesthetic, and then from the dental alignment. From the anterior and posterior relationship, vertical relationship, and transverse relationship of the patient skeletal pattern. Okay, this is the first case. It's a class 1 malocclusion with bimaxillary protrusion. We can see the extraoral photo of this patient. We have 3 photos. The first photo shows the patient sagittal view, and then the middle photo shows a patient in a transverse view, and then the third photo shows that the view when patient is smiling. And then we also have a lateral cephalometric view, and then we also have intraoral view. The first photo is the maxillary view. The second one is the mandibular view. And then the lower one is the inter-arch relationship of the upper and lower teeth. Okay, so we can see that patient has a proclined upper and lower incisors. And then the canine are molar, and molar and incisor are in class 1. And then patient also have a very mild crowding for the upper and lower arch. So what are you going to achieve in your treatment? So you want to maintain the class 1 molar relationship on the both sides. You also want to achieve class 1 canine on the both sides. You want to correct the bimaxillary protrusion to achieve ideal overjet and overbite. And you also want to achieve acceptable aesthetic and soft tissue profile. So, how will you achieve the treatment objective? So, in order to achieve the treatment objective, you need to have a treatment planning. So, in this patient, treatment plan is for extraction of 4 first premolar. And then we put the braces. And after that, when a patient achieves ideal occlusion, we will remove the braces and then we will give upper holy retainers and lower lingual bonded retainer. Okay, in order to formulate treatment plan, you need to have a good knowledge of orthodontics and then how to gain this knowledge of orthodontics. In order to formulate treatment plan, you need to have a basic degree in dentistry, and also you need to learn orthodontic at the master level. Okay, so it's not something simple as cookbook. It's not that you see by maxillary protrusion, then only you need to extract all 4. No, this orthodontic is not a cookbook. Okay, so you need to have a knowledge of orthodontics. You need to have some experience. That's why when you do master degree, you need to have at least 3 to 4 years full-time master program in order to get to gain experience. And then you also need to have a common sense in order to formulate a treatment plan. This is a second case where patient has a class 2 division 1 mild occlusion on a class 2 skeletal pattern with a slightly reduced vertical proportion complicated with crowding. What are you going to achieve in your treatment objective? So in this case, we want to achieve class 1 molar relationship on both sides. And we also want to achieve class 1 canine relation on both sides. We also want to correct the anterior deep bite. And then we want to correct the crowding in the upper and lower anteriors. We also want to correct the retruded chin. We also want to achieve acceptable aesthetic and soft tissue profile. So how you will achieve the treatment objective? So in order to formulate a treatment plan, we need to know the patient age. So it differs. The treatment plan is differs between a growing and non-growing individual. In growing patient, we can consider a twin block functional appliance in this patient. But however, if patient is a non-growing individual, we may need to consider combined orthodontic treatment and orthodontic surgery for this patient. Okay, now this is a class 3 malocclusion. We can see that patient has a class 3 incisor relationship on a class 3 skeletal pattern with increased vertical proportion complicated with crowding. And then what are you going to achieve in your treatment objective? So we would like to correct the skeletal class 3. We would like to achieve the class 1 molar relationship and class 1 canine relationship on both sides. We would like to bring 1-3 into the arch form. We would like to correct the narrow maxillary arch. And then we would like to achieve acceptable aesthetic and soft tissue profile. So how will you achieve the treatment objective? Similar to the class 2 cases just now, the treatment differs between growing patient and a non-growing patient. In a growing patient, we can consider growth modification appliance such as a reverse headgear appliance or face mask. And then, in a non-growing patient, we may need to consider fixed orthodontic treatment with orthodontic surgery. However, if patient is not willing for surgery, we can consider camouflage treatment. However, not all cases in which patient is not willing for surgery is suitable for camouflage treatment. In some cases, braces treatment only without alternative surgery will worsen their occlusion. So there is many factors to consider in a treatment planning.